Thank you to Antone and Brandy for the beautiful prelude this morning. Welcome to First United Methodist Church Richardson. I'm Clayton Oliphant. It's a joy to have you with us today as we worship the Lord together. We hope you'll register your attendance and let us know that you're here. And we're excited today to begin a new sermon series called The Courage to Change. And we're so glad again to have you worshiping with us. We're doing a special project right now. Our Children's First initiative is asking us to do something bold and wonderful, and that is to provide 1,000 books for children in our two partner schools, Greenwood Hills Elementary and Mark Twain Elementary, to receive a book before the end of the school year that they can take home as their own book to take home for summer. Wouldn't that be great to be able to give each child a book? And so what we're asking from you is to donate money for these books. We're not asking for books, we're asking for the money, and we will purchase the book so that every child can take home a book for the summer. I think this is an amazing thing, and wouldn't that be something for every child to take home their own book this summer? If you'd like to donate to that today, we would certainly appreciate it, and I know those children will as well. Again, we're so glad you're here today as we gather together to worship the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Good morning and welcome to our prayer time. I encourage you, as I always do, to look at our prayer list at fumcr.com/pray. There you'll find the names of persons who have asked us to pray for them, and hope you'll do that, as well as an opportunity for you to add your own prayer concerns. Now, as we enter in our own prayer time, I encourage you to have your feet flat on the floor and to lift your hands openly so you can feel the presence of God with you as we pray. And as we begin our prayer, take a deep breath and join with me. Let us pray. Another Easter has come and gone. Lent, Holy Week and the morning of resurrection, another year on the church calendar. We pray, Lord, that this experience of Easter has been a transforming one, as it was for those who experienced the empty tomb and who encountered the resurrected Christ. It was only a routine of our church year. We have missed a boat, and our faith is not as strong as it should be. What we just celebrated in Easter, in the resurrection of our Lord, is far from ordinary. It is transforming, a witness to your transforming power and the call for commitment from each one of us. In this event of resurrection, we receive the gift of new life and are called to be a living sacrifice as well. Easter is the center of our Christian faith, not a one-day celebration on the calendar. In the demonstration of new life from the cross, we are transformed and are called into a new commitment. May we not be drawn back into our routine. May we not be drawn away from you by the voices of our culture. Your love for us, revealed on the cross and in the empty tomb, is the power for us to become who we are meant to be. We are not perfect. We are sinners. We aren't even deserving your love. But we pray that we may truly live transformed with the daily renewing of our minds and our spirits to discern and to strive to fulfill your desire for our lives. You have shown us perfection, and we pray that each step forward for us will be our commitment to fulfill your dream. This we pray in the name of the resurrected one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We certainly appreciate your support of the mission and ministry of First United Methodist Church in Richardson. We hope you'll continue to give. You can do so by texting into the number that's on your screen, or by giving online, or by sending in a check. However you choose to do it, we give you thanks.
Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? And who told the oceans you can only go this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Let us
I love all the songs that we sing after we celebrate Easter. When we name who Jesus is in our lives as the risen Christ, he is our all in all. He's our Redeemer. He is our Savior. And we get to celebrate that over and over again. I'm Cheryl Bishop, Director of Family Ministry, and this is Natalie Ninovich, Associate Director of Children's Ministry, and welcome to Children's Time. We have an amazing opportunity over the next few weeks to watch caterpillars turn into butterflies.
Have you ever had your own butterfly garden? It is the coolest thing. First, you start with a caterpillar that spins into a chrysalis, and then it goes to the top, and you wait, and you wait, and then a butterfly emerges from the chrysalis, and it has wings, and you get to release it and watch it fly away.
One of the cool things that we learn from different kinds of animals is that often they follow patterns throughout their lives based on their instinct. Caterpillar has an instinct to eat and eat and eat and eat and eat so that it prepares itself for when it goes into its chrysalis and it transforms into a butterfly. One of the things that we have the opportunity to do as people of God, is to change too. But we don't change in the same ways. We don't always have an instinct on what to do to change our body so that we might sprout wings. That doesn't happen for us, but we do have natural instincts, and many of you do too. I've seen many of you have a gut reaction, like you just feel it, to know when someone needs to be treated with kindness, when someone needs to be loved, when someone is needing help, and you just know that. And sometimes what stops us from changing is fear. But as we learn about scripture and watch the caterpillars turn into butterflies through these next few weeks together, we will focus on courage to change. That God gives us a spirit of courage to be transformed because of the love of Christ. So we hope that you'll join us over and over again in the coming days and weeks, when we can watch our butterflies change and know that for us, it's a message about having courage to change and be who God is calling us to be. So as we end our time together, let's pray. Are you ready? I'll say a little bit and you can repeat after me. Let's pray together. Creator God.
Creator God.
Thank you for butterflies.
Thank you for butterflies
that flutter on the wind.
That flutter on the wind
to remind us of new life.
To remind us of new life.
Help us.
Help us
find ways we need to change.
Find ways we need to change
and have the courage to do it.
And have the courage to do it.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
We'll see you next time.
I'm Pavielle Jenkins, and I'm reading our scripture today from Romans 12, verses 1 through 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
My name is Clayton Oliphant, and I'm the pastor of the church. And again, I want to tell you how good it is to have you worshiping with us today. At the bottom of your screen, there's a number, and we would love to connect with you. You can text to connect with us today. Tell us who you are, where you're worshiping from. And also, we'd love to know if you have any prayer concerns that we could be praying with you and for you about. We would love for you to text those concerns to that number at the bottom of your screen. Today, we're beginning a new sermon series called The Courage to Change. And I want to ask you a question. Has anybody ever said to you, "You can't tell me what to do"? Or have you ever said, "You can't tell me how to live my life"? And isn't that one of the fundamental things about being human is that we want to be in control of our own destiny. We don't like other people telling us how to live. As a pastor, I've had people tell me, you don't need to preach to me and tell me how to live my life. I'm doing fine on my own. And, you know, there's something to that that I resonate with. None of us like to be told what to do. We like to live our lives the way we want to live our lives, on our terms. We don't like to be told what to do. I remember being 18 years old and telling my mother, I'm 18. I can do whatever I want to do. I'm 18 years old. And she said, that's interesting for someone who sleeps under a roof that they don't pay for and eats food that they don't pay for to be able to say that. And it was the first time I remember my mother almost laughing at me with the silly statement, I can do whatever I want to do. She's like, not as long as you're living under this roof, you can't. And I wonder sometimes if we confuse our freedom with in terms of how God wants us to live our lives, that God has set us free to live, for sure, and that we are called to live our lives, and yet there's something about our desire versus God's desire for our lives, and this struggle that we have to give ourselves fully to God versus doing it our way. You know, it's an amazing thing to see people who have the courage to make changes in their lives. And it does take courage to change. And one of the most important changes you will ever make in your life is this decision, am I going to go my way and live my way, or am I going to try to live and strive in my life to live God's way? That courage to take that step toward God's way is one of the most important decisions you'll ever make. How does that begin? I mean, how do you turn your life toward God? I mean, assuming that you want to do that, assuming that you've realized that doing your own thing, your own way, is not producing the results that you'd like to see. And so, in order to maybe get your life aligned correctly, you realize that maybe there's a better way. Maybe God has a better idea for your life than you do. Maybe there's a way that you could live your life that would make more sense if you're following God's direction and not your own direction. Now, if you haven't figured that out already, maybe I'm the one to coach you into that. Maybe you want to continue to try it on your own. And you know, if you choose to do that, more power to you. It's just a lot of us have found the hard way. That's a road that doesn't lead anywhere. That's a road that leads to emptiness because it's all about you and living for yourself. And God tells us that the way to freedom, the way to really live your life freely, is to give your life away. And not for it not to be all about you, but for it to be about God and about others before you put yourself in the equation. To live your life as an offering to God. Where do we begin? I mean, well, the Masters golf tournament will be finalized today, and there'll be a champion. When did that champion win the golf tournament? A lot of you would say, well, the championship was decided today. But I would submit to you that championship, that title of Masters champion, whoever it is that wins that tournament today, that was determined by the thousands of hours that person spent practicing and honing their craft to get them to the point to be in position today to win a Masters title. When did Baylor win the NCAA basketball championship? Some of you say, well, last Monday night. But I would submit to you that was done in the off season, and it was done when a coach was hired who instilled a culture that changed that program. That is how things... See, I'm not a believer in fast turnarounds, quick turnarounds. If you want to change, it's hard work. And it takes a lot of determination. It takes a lot of fortitude to day by day pursue your goal. It's not a fast fix. It's not a quick turnaround. I don't believe in that, whether you're talking about getting in shape, losing weight, making money, or any other kind of endeavor that you might want to pursue. And when it comes to your faith and making a change in your life to begin to live for God instead of just for yourself, it's not a quick fix. It's a daily practice. It's a daily discipline of your life to move in a Godward direction. And Paul invites us in Romans chapter 12 to make this change, to make this shift in our minds. And he begins by saying, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Think about that. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice. That means that your life becomes an offering to God. If you want to begin the change of living toward God's way and not just your own way, the first step is to see your life, your being, your person as an offering, that what you are, who you are, is an offering to God. Every day, you have an opportunity to pour yourself out as an offering to God. You know, there was a church I heard of years ago where a little boy, when the offering plate was passed, he put the plate on the floor and stepped on into the offering plate. And it was said of that little boy that that little boy understood more about what it means to be a Christian than any of the rest of the people in the church. That it was not just about giving a dollar or two in the plate. It was about putting your whole life in that plate, putting your whole life in God's hands. And what a powerful image that is, to see your life as an offering to God. You know, in the Old Testament, there were times when people would make animal sacrifices to God to atone for their sins. And so they would present sacrifices the prophet Micah said, what does the Lord require of us? Does the Lord require sacrifices? No, the Lord requires to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. You know, it's more about our being, not just what we do in terms of bringing sacrifices. It's about sacrificing our life, that we are a living sacrifice. And that's what Paul is talking about here. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, that you yourself become an offering to God. I think the second thing I would lift up to you today is that we are called to not conform, but to be transformed. Not to conform to the world, but to be transformed by the renewal of our minds. And this is a step that I think so many of us as Christians struggle with in this present age. There's a real challenge for those of us who call ourselves followers of Christ that we don't look that different than the rest of the world at times. And I was talking to one of our church members earlier this week, and we were talking about, you know, that Christians should be different. We should appear different than the rest of the world. That we don't need to enter into the rhetoric, the divisive rhetoric of our time. We don't have to enter into this hate speech where we hate people who are different than we are. As Christians, we are to embody the love of Jesus Christ. And that is our goal. That's the change toward which we're working. That's the life toward which we are seeking to live, to look like Jesus, to live like Jesus. I mean, that is the goal, isn't it? That our lives become a reflection of the love of Jesus Christ. And we have to ask ourselves, you know, are we doing that on a daily basis? No, we all fail. But we strive toward it. We never get there without those daily steps. It's that hard work and discipline, those daily steps we take toward that goal. So Paul says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. What Paul is talking about here is a metamorphosis. It's that change that happens, like when a caterpillar goes into a cocoon and emerges as a butterfly. And I heard about a child who saw a cocoon and that the butterfly was trying to emerge from the cocoon. And the child thought that she would help that butterfly along by cutting, taking some scissors and cutting the cocoon so that the butterfly could more freely emerge from the cocoon. But the butterfly couldn't fly. Why was that? Because it's the struggle of getting out of the cocoon that builds the strength in the wings for that butterfly to be able to fly. There's something about the struggle itself of disciplining ourselves and going through the struggle day by day of striving to be the people God has called us to be. That struggle itself produces a better outcome than we could ever get on our own. Or if someone had just cleared our path and made it easy. It's not easy. You know, being a Christian is not easy. And there's something about that struggle that helps us emerge stronger, that we're able then to fly because we've struggled. I don't believe in overnight successes. I think there's something that happens when we struggle, when we strive daily, the discipline of daily work toward being the people God wants us to be that makes us better people. You know, at some point in your life, you have to decide what kind of person you want to be and what kind of principles are going to guide your life. And then you work toward that. Is it a perfect process? No. It's never a perfect process because we're human beings. But we strive, and it's in the striving that we become greater and more than we could ever be. So here's this word for us. Don't be conformed to the world. Don't do it like everybody else. Don't act like everybody else. And you can say, well, other people do it that way, and I would do it different, but they did it, you know, this person did this to me. No. We're called to be different. We're called not to be conformed to this world. We're called to be transformed by the renewal of our minds. Our goal is to look like Jesus and to live like Jesus. And if that becomes the goal toward which we're striving, then it's the daily discipline that we have to check ourselves. We have to have the courage to change, the courage to be different, the courage to love and not to hate. That takes great, great courage, doesn't it? To really put yourself in God's hands, the courage to be different in your life, to choose the way of Jesus versus the way of the world. That's what Paul's talking about here when he says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And then it is that last thing about renewing your mind. How do you get your mind connected to the heart of Jesus? How do you get your mind aligned with the mind of God? I love that passage in Philippians where Paul says, have this same mind in you that was in Christ Jesus, who didn't count equality with God as something to be exploited, but he humbled himself and became a servant. You know, that renewal of your mind, to have the mind of Christ and not just our own mind at work in the world, but to strive to align our minds with the mind and the heart of Christ. Years ago, Grant, my son, who's about to graduate from college and get married, which is mind-blowing in and of itself, But years ago, we went to a 3D movie, and I'll never forget, you know, seeing the clarity of images, and like several times the audience flinched in response to something coming out in a 3D. If you've ever been to a 3D movie, you've seen that kind of image. About halfway through the movie, I became kind of interested and took my glasses, my 3D glasses off and looked at the screen. And what I saw was kind of a jumbled image, kind of a mess of images. And you could see the different characters, but it was all jumbled. And when I put the 3D glasses back on, it's like these images that were blurry and kind of like double vision suddenly came together in such a powerful way. The crystal clear image of that was so striking. I think that God calls us to put on the glasses of faith. They're the glasses of grace. And when we do that, we see that which is scattered and just unfocused becomes crystal clear. That when we seek to have the mind of Christ and renew our lives and make these changes in our lives, that we see with clarity the direction we are to go, and it's found in the love and in the life of Jesus. It's found as we study more about Jesus and seek to live and be and serve like Jesus. So, no one can tell you what to do with your life. That's true. You have to make a choice. And it takes great courage to make a change in your life. You may think, well, I'm too old to change, or I don't want to change. That's your choice. But God does offer you a choice. God offers you a way of life that is fulfilling and rich and empowering and liberating. It's the way of servanthood. It's the way of giving your life over as an offering to God, that you live not just for yourself, that you live for God and for others. And when you do that, you will find a life truly worth living. Where do you begin? Every journey begins with the first step. And then tomorrow you take another step. And the next day you take another step. So what are you going to do today to bring about the changes you want to see tomorrow? As I said, it's not a quick fix. It's a daily journey. And the good news is, on this journey, we're not alone. God is with us to give us strength. Let's pray together. Gracious God, give us the courage to make the changes in our lives that will produce outcomes that we can't even begin to see. I pray for that person who's struggling with a change they know they need to make, but haven't had the heart to make yet, that today would be a day when they would take that first step towards you. Lord, there's sometimes that we feel like we take two steps forward and then two steps back. But the fact that we're on the journey, striving to walk toward your way, is in and of itself a blessing. And I pray that that for all of us, you would strengthen our inner determination, our inner core, that we may truly seek to not be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewal of our minds. Align our minds with your mind, O Lord. And in that perfect unison, may we find the way that leads to life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's someone here today who would unite with our church family, a family of faith we call First United Methodist Church Richardson. By your profession of faith in Christ for the first time or for the first time in a long time, or by transferring your membership to our church, we would love to connect with you this week. You see the address on your screen, join@fumcr.com. Send an email to that address. We'd love to connect with you and receive you into membership of the church or answer any questions you have about what it means to be a member of the church or a follower of Christ. Again, we're so glad that you're worshiping with us this day. Let's continue our worship. Thank you to all of our musicians for the beautiful music that's been a part of our worship experience today. We know that we are incredibly blessed by our talented music team here at First United Methodist Church Richardson. As you go into the world this week, I want to invite you to make those changes that make sense in your life as you seek to follow and connect with God's way for your life. It's hard to do it on your own and pursue your own path. It's liberating to follow God's way. So I invite you to take that first step this week. Change is hard and it takes courage, but God is with you and will give you strength to make the changes that will lead you to life in all of its fullness. Be blessed this week.